Hello, 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 hello. You are welcome back to Hugh's Convos. And with me is Ozie on today's podcast, The Game. We will be having another swell time. Today, we're going to be completing the book of Mark chapter 8. And we started, we went halfway, and now we're going to complete the whole session for you. But before we start, get your pens, get your pads, get your Bible, and let's get to studying. Welcome, welcome. Hope you're ready. Ozie, how are you doing?
I am well, thank you. How are you doing? I'm still waking up, actually. Well, not waking up, but I had like a very long week, so I am adjusting to life inside the house. I've been sleeping in the tent for a week.
Ozie just got started with his missions work and coordinating students. I can imagine how hectic it has been for him, and years to many more years of no sleep. Ozie? Yeah.
I think it was brilliant. I loved it. The only downside was sleeping in the tent when it was heavily raining. But outside of that, everything was great.
Oh, well, it's part of what you do to serve the Lord, isn't it? You count the cost and then you go into it. It's the sacrifice.
Which, interestingly, is what we're talking about today.
Yeah. Yeah, that's actually true. Yeah, it's been amazing. It's the start of the new academic year. Got officially inducted at Redeemer University. We had a task to shine the light of the gospel. Amen. In business. And we've had an amazing, it's hectic. Lots of students coming back to school, but we bless the Lord. It's an opportunity to influence lives again.
By the way, I have to, you know, publicly with everybody watching, say congratulations to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Amazing.
It is amazing.
I was super excited to see your photos, like, yesterday. Aww. When I got back. I was like, I know him. I know this guy. I know people.
It was a surreal moment. We just, it's beautiful to be able to teach secular subjects while also giving the students a Christian worldview. And I remember I did ask the students in class, can we do business as Christians in today's world? And quite a number of them agreed, yes, we can do business as Christians in today's world. And I was happy. But I asked, is it difficult? They said, yes, it is difficult, but it is possible to do that. And I'm just glad to be part of those who will be raising a new generation of business leaders thinking from a Christian worldview. Amen. Okay, amen. So we are starting with Mark 8. We stopped at Mark 8:26, and we saw the healing of the blind man, and we saw there were different stages of his healing. First, he saw men as trees, and then eventually he saw things clearly. And Jesus let him go, and in verse 26, the Bible says, Jesus sent him home, saying, don't even go into the village. I mean, he's trying to keep it all quiet. And then now we're going into verse 27. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages and around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, who do people say I am? This is coming off of the back of feeding the Gentiles, warning them about the yeast of the Pharisees, and then getting angry at their a lack of understanding of what he said, because they thought it was about bread. And then now he heals a blind man. And we said last episode, Mark is arranging this deliberately. So he shows there's a lack of understanding and the lack of sight. And then there's somebody who's blind who receives sight twice in those ways. And now Jesus asked another question, a very, very more direct question now. Who do you people say that I am? And he says, they replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others one of the prophets. Jesus is probing into their perspective, I would say, what people think of Jesus. So he wants to ask, what do other people think that I am? And then he goes and asks the next question. Now, what about you? Now, this is my emphasis. What about you? He asked, who do you say I am? And Peter answered, you are the Messiah. And Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. This is a striking, how do I call that? A striking part in this chapter. I mean, like we say in the business world, piggyback off of what has happened in the previous happenings there. And then Jesus is now asking a question to see if these people are actually seeing correctly. Do you see and understand correctly now? After all the lessons you've had, what are people saying? And what are you saying? And that's really, really what mattered to Jesus. People will perceive as, for instance, Elijah had been prophesied. There's a lot of writings that have shown that Elijah was going to return. And in Mark chapter 1, Mark already alluded to that, talking about the return of Elijah and then seeing John coming in that fashion. But of course, I think in the book of John, Jesus already said Elijah was that. Was it John or Matthew? I already said John was the Elijah that is to come, if you would be able to believe that. And so now, some are saying it is Elijah because of what he's doing, and others are saying you're just one of the prophets. One thing that is beautiful about what people are saying about Jesus is, irrespective, they are all seeing somebody who, at least they are acknowledging, this is someone with some form of authority. But of course, a lot of the miracles and things he did were undeniable, at least according to the writer in the book of Mark. They were undeniable. They saw these things. There was no way they could deny. He has to be something. Either he's a prophet or he's Elijah to come. But there's a part that Jesus wanted them to grasp, which he has been pushing since the beginning of Mark, according to Mark. Forgiving sins, you know, healing diseases, casting out spirit, telling them he has authority over Sabbath. There's a message he's passing across. Now, he's taking the disciples on this journey. And then at this point, he's now asking, who do you say that I am? And Jesus and Peter says, you are the Messiah. I'll take back, before I get back to Uzziah, I'll take back onto what being a Messiah was to them. They all expected a Messiah to come. Ideally from the tribe of David or from the line of David to establish the Davidic kingdom. But if you're having a Messiah like that, their focus was not in the spiritual side of it. It was in somebody who would come with so much. I would believe he also needed an army because he had to topple the Roman kingdom or the Roman rule that they were tired of. This is the kind of Messiah they're looking for. Just like there's a country now, I'm not going to mention the name. They are really, really looking for a Messiah to rescue them from the horrors. this is besides the point. But yeah, this is exactly what's going on. So they are expecting a Messiah who's going to rescue them from the Roman rule. And so the kind of Messiah they're thinking, I would think the kind of Messiah Peter is thinking about here might be different from the Messiah we see today, or how we think about him is, of course, by the time we get to the book of Acts, Peter sees him in a different form of Messiah, right? Yeah. But at this point, I don't think he's seeing him the way we see him. But at least he recognizes this anointed one who has come to rescue us, who has come to free us from this oppression of the Roman rule, is here. Although he has no army, he is not from one of the most, affluent homes. As a matter of fact, his birth, according to the other recordings of the gospel, they do not even line up with somebody who comes from that form of affluent background. Yet, Peter sees him as the Messiah. Jesus acknowledges this and says, don't tell anyone. And typically, Messiahs don't even accept the title until the work is done. You understand? You only say someone is a Messiah after they've actually done what, you know, so he comes as a revolutionist, he comes around, turns things around, and eventually establishes the kingdom. Then he says, yeah, that guy is the Messiah. And he says, don't tell anyone about him. So, Uzziah, what do you think about this?
I think the Bible is the greatest hit in the entire world. And when we go to the end, when we go to the through the stories or the different books, we are blown and mesmerized. As I'm looking at this story, one of Jesus' last questions to them is, don't you still understand?
Mm-hmm.
And so when Peter says this, you are like, at least finally they get it. They get the point that Mark has been trying to make. But Mark is brilliant, because the more you think about it, you say, They get the point that Jesus is making now. He is the Messiah. He is God come in the flesh, in quotes. But do they really? You know, that's not the question that...
That's right.
that will now, as we explore chapter 9, the question now is, but did they really understand? Did they get it? Because as Jesus asks, as Jesus is asking them, so who do people say that I am? And of course, like you described, people have all these theories. But you guys who have been with me, you have seen all these things. You have seen the loaves multiplied several times with the fishes. You have seen all the healings. You have been with me. Who do you say that I am? And then Peter is like, actually, you are the Messiah. In John, it accounts that he says, flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but my Father.
Yeah.
And that's such a powerful moment.
Yeah.
But then the next question is, what is your view of the Messiah? And so if we're going to switch on to a pastoral moment, you can believe in Jesus. You can have the message of the gospel and you can say, yes, I am a Christian true and true. Maybe I didn't grow up in, I believe the message, but what really is the gospel that you preach? What really is the message that you are heralding? Because it's one thing to really champion the name Jesus so much, but what does that entail? Because as we read further, Jesus is going to describe what being a Messiah is.
Yes.
And it clearly is not what Peter is thinking of.
That's correct. Yes.
It's by far not close in semblance to what Peter has in mind when he is thinking about the phrase, the excitement that comes with the word Messiah. Because like you rightly mentioned, the Jews are under the thumb of the Romans. And so their mindset of this king to come is something that they're excited about. But you know, it's almost as if they have selective reading, because still in the text there is the message, there's this theme of the suffering servant that has been going all through, and Prophet Isaiah does a fantastic job to describe it even more fully. But you know, they'll be like, who is this suffering servant who is going to be like a king? Don't worry, we'll just stick to the king part. That one is more interesting. I don't want any more suffering. I just like the king guy. You know, that's the guy that will come and topple the government. And Israel will take his place once more as the people of God, no more relegated to evil, pain, and suffering.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what they're waiting for. And sadly, in some of our lives, many people have sold us that dream of Christianity, that once you come to Jesus, you know, come to Jesus and you get healed, and come to Jesus and everything will be great in your life. And Jesus is almost like, the Messiah is here and everything is going to be great. But then, as we will read for that, the Messiah is like, well,
there's a plot twist.
So again, I want our listeners and people watching to still have that question that Jesus asked them earlier in this chapter. Do you still not understand? Like, you know, we kind of expanded on that more in our last video. But this is still the question that Matt is using to linger as he goes through this chapter. So at this point now, we are excited because it does feel as if there is some semblance of understanding of the role of Jesus and who he is. So as the audience of Mark now, we're like, aha, yes, he gets it. But as we explore even further, you see that he doesn't. And I have to identify with Peter strongly, because if I'm being honest in my life, I know that Jesus is God and Jesus is Messiah, but sometimes the way I think or what my expectations of God is not in line with what God is actually doing. And sometimes I may be like Peter. Anyway, we're going to read that, so let me not jump the gun here.
To be fair, I mean, first part, historically, I think the idea of the suffering Messiah, from what I've been reading, wasn't popular until maybe after the second century. It wasn't really popular in their time for them to understand that the Messiah was going to suffer. A lot of these parallels, I would say, were drawn later on, especially when we are looking at now a Christian worldview.
Yeah.
If we were coming through from a Jewish worldview, that was not how they saw it. So later on, by the time even our current arrangement of the Bible, this, and then making it have that story of the gospel, comes from a more Protestant tradition of trying to see things from a Christian point of view. So we now had those arrangements, and then now everything is fitting into place. And then, of course, by the time these guys are writing this, this is long after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Yeah, it was easy for them to go back. In fact, there are a lot of arguments where some people say, I go into some of those readings and where they say, sometimes, even I have seen that when these gospel writers are writing, there's a superimposition of an Old Testament text just to fit into an idea. Even though when you go back to that Old Testament text, they may not share the same context. Do you understand? But you can understand that they were trying to pull that, which makes a lot of sense. So at this time, I would understand that we probably didn't grasp the idea of a suffering Messiah. But you're right in the sense of there's two questions that's asked. What do people say? And what do you say? Yeah. Which I come to see is a necessary question. If you're taking it from a pastoral point of view, it's a necessary question to ask yourself. What do people say, or who do people say Jesus is? And what do you personally say Jesus is to you? This is very important to answer, because a lot of people are under a crowd mentality of who Jesus is. So their relationship with Jesus is as good as the crowd. It's not necessarily on the personal level. Their understanding of Jesus is flowing with the crowd. And then so when this sort of people are challenged in their personal view of Jesus Christ, it's almost as if they crumble, because they've never had any time to see who Jesus is. I've come to understand that it's very hard for some people to even ask that question. When you ask some Christians, in quotes, is Jesus your savior? It's very hard to understand for them, because they actually even grasp, they don't have any idea of what it means when they say Jesus is my Messiah. All they've understood is what they have done in what people have said in song. So when they're in church, they feel good. When they listen to the pastor, they feel good. But on a personal level, I think a question you need to ask yourself is, who is Jesus to me? And who do I say he is? Because if you can answer that question convincingly to yourself, you can weather almost any storm. Because there is a conviction inside your heart that now you know. But the problem usually is there's a gap. There's the knowing who Jesus is amongst the church, amongst the crowd, amongst group, which is amazing. So my pastor said, this is who Jesus is. My mother says, this is who Jesus is. My father told me this is who Jesus is. But it has to move from that, what people told me. And from what we see here, the perception the crowd have of Jesus is not actually the right perception. Does that make sense? They saw him as either Elijah or saw him as a prophet, which wasn't the perception Jesus wanted. I mean, to be fair, and that's not what he was representing. And yet, this perception was a popular perception of Christ. And there's a possibility that even in today, now this is me just drawing, making, using this as an example or allegory or something, and say there's a possibility today that sometimes our perception of Christ is not accurate. It may be popular. And I remember, I think there was a quote by Tim Keller where he talked about, show me the God or the Christ that you rejected, and probably I'll reject him too. Does this make sense? Yeah, that's me paraphrasing it. Show me the Christ or the God you actually hate or reject, and I probably reject that same God too. Because why? It was a wrong perception that was handed down to you. And to be fair, I've had that experience. Talking with people, and they say, I walked away from Christianity. I walked away from the faith. And then when I have conversations, if that's the God or the Christ that were presented, I would walk away myself. I literally will reject that God because he doesn't make sense. Does this make sense? I remember I had the long conversation. I remember back then in Cyprus with someone who, I think they were of another faith entirely. I don't want to mention that to keep the personal details, but they had this idea of Christianity. And when they presented the idea of Christianity to me, I said, I hate that too. That's not who I serve. And they were shocked. Do you understand? And then I presented the God I'm learning of, that I'm understanding. Mm-hmm. And they couldn't grasp me. Like, I mean, at some point they said, I don't want to talk to you again. Now you're making me poke holes in what I believe. You're making me question things that I believe. I don't think I want to have this conversation. They were honest, but I applaud that. So some people have been introduced to a perception of who Christ is, which is a wrong perception. And till my dying breath, it's something that I hope to be able to influence in my little way, try my best as possible and present a Christ that is presented through history and through the Bible, even through all the misconceptions and contradictions people may see. There is a God working in there, and that convicts the heart. So not following what the crowd says, but what you personally hold of Christ is as important. And like Ozzy said, they said, you are the Messiah. Okay, Peter said, you are the Messiah. But I'm going to draw this back to the healing that happened. When the guy was healed first, he saw things in a blurry way. Yeah. The view of Peter as the Messiah now is a blurry vision. We will see that. It's a very blurry vision, because later on they get the clear vision. And they realize, is what you mean all the way. But
yeah.
I'll pause there and then let's read that so we can see what the blurry visual
is. This is why I said the Bible is the greatest hits. You know, I've heard people talk about how can we give our life or dedicate our life to this book that was written by some good headmen, good shepherds or illiterate guys in a bush. And take their words seriously. But then, once you settle down and properly read it, in fact, even if I exclude myself from my feelings or my faith and I just read the text, the brilliancy in the text itself, the connections, I mean, now we hear, it's like watching a movie in real life, because now it says, do you still understand? They don't understand. And then Jesus heals a man, he heals him twice. I mean, many people have been stuck on that miracle, which is quite sad, because they miss the point that Mark is going to explain further. So
yeah,
he heals, and then Jesus asks the question, who do men say I am? Peter says, you are the Messiah. Mm-hmm. The question is, why has Mark arranged all these stories in line with each other? Because they are supposed to connect. It's a congruent story that Mark is telling for specific reasons. These men had years and years and years to put together the story of the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
They were written maybe 10, 20, 40 years afterwards. So they would have properly processed everything and distilled it to points that they felt was necessary.
Yeah.
So because of that, it wouldn't be just careless writing. It's not like they're not just writing it like, okay, he did this and then this happened and then this happened. No, they are crafting a really brilliant story that has layers and layers. And so what you just said is exciting. He heals the man and he heals him twice. First one, I still see men like trees. And then he heals him again. And then we go to Peter's story. Peter says, you are the Messiah. But no, Peter is still seeing the Messiah like trees. That's the point Mark is trying to say. He's trying to see that Peter has some form of vision of who Jesus is, but it's still blurry. He doesn't get it completely, and still needs Jesus. Anyway, my excitement is starting to show too much.
It's a blurry vision. So let's read the next part. So, and then he then began to teach. Actually, let me read from the screen here. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, after 3 days rise again. Like I said, in this time, it wasn't popular for them to hear of his suffering Messiah. The person coming to free you from Roman oppression is also now going to suffer. What? Then the freedom is gone. Do you get what I'm trying to say? There's no freedom to expect anymore if this guy is as weak as this. He's supposed to portray a strong a vibrant, somebody who could lead a revolution. But he's saying he was rejected. The elder, I mean, does this remind you of when Moses was rejected by the elders? And who had made you a ruler over us? And then he had to do convincing things. So Jesus now is saying he'll be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and teachers of law, and then he will be killed. Where is there a Messiah who's killed? So when we hear Messiah, let's Messiah not think of a Messiah of when we talk about salvation. We think of Messiah then. They are looking for a revolution, somebody who's going to free them. And then now you say he's going to be killed. That's the end of the revolution. That's the end of any form of restoration. And on after 3 days, they will rise again. Trust me, at this point, Peter is like, that blurry vision is even becoming blurrier. He's not seeing clearly. He's like, what exactly are you talking about? And he spoke plainly about this. And Peter, now you can get why Peter took him aside to rebuke. Because he has said you're the Messiah. He tells you the expectations he's having of the Messiah. And then he took him aside and began to rebuke him. First and foremost, to rebuke your own teacher at this time is you have broken protocol. You can't, because your teacher is your mentor. So rebuking is not just, no, I don't believe that. No, rebuking is sharp. He pulls him aside and says, what do you mean? What nonsense are you saying? Exactly. I just said you're the Messiah. You're going to free us from this oppression. Now you look and then you tell me you're going to die. You know that if you die and we start this revolution, all of us are gone. We're all goners because we're your followers.
And I think another thing to add is that, again, more credit to Peter. We should see ourselves more like Peter. Remember that these guys had given up everything to follow Jesus.
Correct.
They had given up their businesses. Peter, at this time, at least we know Peter is married, but he has left. He's left. He's not traveling with his wife. So he's left his home. He's left his family behind. They too have lost something because they believe in this new Jesus movement. They are drawn to it. So these men have given up everything they had because they believe the Messiah is here. They believe who he is. And I mean, they are hoping for the restoration of Israel and they are part of that movement. So there's the excitement. Mm-hmm. So for you to then tell me that everything I have done is for nothing, please come, let's have a conversation about this.
And that everything is going to crash soon. Because once you die, that's the end. There's really nothing. And it also tells you, I think I mentioned it sometime, their motive for following him in the beginning, which is like every other person. Their motive, what they thought, their expectations, now Jesus is crumbling it. And it's unfair to build what Mark has been building from Mark 1, build that, oh my God, this guy is healing people, he's doing all this, and now we found our Messiah. This guy is going to do mighty things. And then all of a sudden he says, I'm going to die, guys. But on the third day, see, that part of rising again didn't really fly. It flew over their heads. Like, on the third day, I'll rise again. It wasn't really a focus.
I would like to say, so about that part, if you remember, in that moment, in their context, there was a huge argument about resurrection.
Oh, of course, between the Pharisees and the Sadducees.
That was one of the stark differences between the Pharisees and Sadducees. And in fact, their idea of resurrection was not even immediate. If you notice, if you remember the story of Martha and Mary, when Jesus shows up and says, your brother will rise again, he was like, I know he will rise again someday.
Yeah, that's correct.
So,
so the
Jesus is just spitting things that are just not sensible. Like, it's like, look, you're listening to a lunatic speak. It's like, is this our king?
It's not adding up.
First of all, we've given everything up, and then you are spouting all this nonsense like some people that would know, which is a contentious conversation.
Yeah.
But I like, if people would go back, go to Acts chapter 5, and, I mean, see something powerful that happens. So this same Peter and John were in prison after they were preaching the message of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And so they called them to the council. And they were like, what would we do with these guys? Then one of the high priests, I think it was Gamaliel, that said, look, these guys are saying they are serving God. If we continue to fight against them and it is indeed that they are speaking the truth.
Yeah,
they were fighting against God.
That's right. Yeah.
But then something that he said that jumped out to me, I can never forget. He's like, Messiahs die. And yeah. Once the leader of the movement dies, everything dies off. Movement. Yeah. So if these guys are actually serving the living God, and this is true, they were fighting God. But if it's not true, since their Messiah is dead, give it time.
Don't worry. He's going to die.
There have been other people like him that have up before and died up.
Yeah.
And so this is their mindset. There have been people that would save them or be the Messiah or something. And then once the person dies, everything dies with the person.
Yeah.
There's nothing about the person that is memorable again. He just becomes, one of those guys that tried. So that's then correct. Jesus coming to say, I will be killed, and I will rise again. We as Christians now, we have a framework for resurrection because Jesus did resurrect.
That's right.
We believe it, we know it, it's the basis of our faith. The resurrection is there. But these guys, it was contended that resurrection was even a thing.
Yeah.
Or plausible, but it was not even immediate resurrection. It was at the end of the day.
At the end of the day, yeah.
Later. So let's try to be in Peter's shoes and see all the things that's happening. Because then again, this is blurry vision time.
Yeah, it's blurry vision. And it's going to be blurry for a long time. Very, very long time until the final vision is restored. In verse 33, but when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Now, my debate comes here, where a lot of popular belief is that Jesus was not addressing Peter. He was addressing the demon behind Peter. And it comes from this is my belief. I think it comes from a longstanding belief of the interpretation of the word Satan, which means an accuser. And often people, when, of course, that title eventually is now being used for the devil or the person, the figure. I want to use that word, the figure that is anti-God. Let me use that one now.
Yeah.
But before then, Satan has always been used, can be used for anything. It literally just means an accuser. If you want to take a position, maybe as a priest, there will be people in front of you at the time, a council. Those people are Satan. They are accusers. They will stand to prove you. They will ask you opposing questions. I'm sure you've heard of things like the devil's advocate.
Yeah.
Correct. So the accuser is just a figure that accuses you or stands or opposes or challenges you. So when... Yeah. The Bible says Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan." He is not, I do not think he's necessarily addressing a demon per se, but he's addressing Peter as an accuser because Peter is right here challenging and opposing what Jesus has just laid out, saying, "No, you're not going to die." And that death is very crucial to Jesus's mission on earth. And then now Peter is offering something entirely different and even rebuking him over it. So he says, "Your concerns is not what God's concerns are," which rightfully so, when we see that Jesus' mission was to come save his people by true death, burial, and resurrection. We see that that was his mission. Anything against that mission is not following the concern of God. Does that make sense? I think this is from my view. So anything that is against that mission that Jesus was coming for was against the plan of God, which is what the Pharisees were as well. The Pharisees continually contended Jesus' mission on earth, right? And then, so when Jesus said that, he says, "Your concern is merely human concerns. You're focused on," and which is true. I don't think it was a demon, which was actually true. All the disciples there following him, their concerns were human concerns. How are we going to be saved from Roman rule? How is our kingdom going to be restored? Does that make sense? It also tells you the fact of how some of them wanted to sit by his right and some by the left. And some of them were even asking, who is going to be the greatest? Who is going to be the least? Do you understand? Who is going to be the most loved? You could tell their concerns were human. And that's not bad. It's what every one of us have. We have these human concerns and we're thinking about so many things. But that was not Jesus's plan. It was against this plan. Anybody could be Satan in our lives. Do you get what I'm trying to say? Anybody, I'm not saying in terms of a demonic sense, anybody can accuse and stand as an opposition to what God's plan is. Doesn't mean they're demonic. It just means their concerns or their mindset is different from your mindset. So this is what I see here. Ozie, what do you see there?
You know, I would like to say that before we started this recording, we were having a conversation about theology and how people mm-hmm. have certain things ingrained in them that they don't know the origin of that.
Yeah, theology that's right.
They have.
Yeah.
Now, yeah. Many people will hear what you have just said, and you know they would have issues with that because they already believe that the word Satan is the mm-hmm. name of the being.
Yes.
But nowhere in the Bible has that being been given a name. It's just made reference to. So even when we read the book of Job mm-hmm. and we see that great counsel, it says even the Satan shows up.
Mm-hmm.
It's the picture that is being painted every time we think about this. It's like a courtroom scene where you have the prosecutor and the defense attorney.
Defense, yeah.
So the prosecutor, the person who is prosecuting the case, is against. He is trying to go against. And this is why they call the being, the Satan, is because his job is to go against Christ, against Christians. So anyone who does something similar, like you have mentioned, is, in sense, maybe if we should change the phrase to say prosecutor, people would be more relaxed. But all these phrases, like the being's name is not Satan. Satan is like a title similar to Lucifer. Because anyway, let's not go into can of worms. One of the best phrases I've heard from Ryan Keating. I don't know if he got it from somewhere, mm-hmm. but during one of our classes, we were talking about Jesus and his sacrifice. He says, what makes Jesus different is that King Jesus and the kingdom of Jesus is other kingdoms come to take kingdoms by crushing them. But Jesus doesn't rule his enemies by crushing them. He rules by dying for them.
Mm-hmm.
It is the upside down nature of the kingdom. It is the antithesis of what we believe to be true. So every time we watch every movie possible, mm-hmm. and there is a fight between good and evil, how good wins is evil is going to slash. Sorry, good is going to slash evil's head.
Evil. Mm-hmm.
It's like in the stories we read, you know, all the movies, it's all borrowed from that theme. Good conquers evil by crushing it. In fact, when we read the creation stories of other histories, it starts off by this great war between good and evil, and then evil crushes good, and then anyway.
Mm-hmm.
That is the mindset we have. But the message of the gospel is that God is doing something completely different. Good is going to win, not by crushing, but by subjecting himself to be crushed. And then through that crushing, life is born.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the weirdest, but the most powerful message of the Bible. And mm-hmm. this is why we as Christians have hope. This is why we live in hope, is that when we live in this world with all the evil we see, and we believe that evil is winning, the Bible tells us that through that evil, through that crushing of evil, good will be birthed. This is one of the underlining messages of the gospel that has radically transformed my life. Mm-hmm. Because in our world where we're used to evil crushing good,
mm-hmm.
the ultimate good, God, Jesus himself,
mm-hmm.
lays his life down. That through what we absolutely think is the worst horrendous things, mm-hmm. through that, the ultimate good is birth. And interestingly, God has laced it in everything we can imagine. So take for example, when we plant a seed,
mm-hmm.
what happens to that seed is when we plant a seed, the seed is destroyed and it has to crack open. But then once that seed cracks open, new life starts sprouting out. It is hidden in the lines of even the world we have. Part of how God has created the world, that even creation is mm-hmm. speaking and giving the message of the gospel. Because not just that the seed has to crack open, but you have to bury seeds too. You have to mm-hmm. put them in the dirt. And it is through that we see something sprout forth. And mm-hmm. so the ways and the plans of God and how God works is so different, so other from how we are, that whenever we think about God, we are just awestruck. Just marveling. Because
mm-hmm.
when he says, you are not setting your heart on what, you know, the things of God, but the things of man, mm-hmm. it's because our natural instinct as humans is crushing. But God's plan and God's ways is not crushing, but submitting himself to be crushed for the mm-hmm. birth of life. And this is just an encouragement, because with that theme in mind, this is what happens with evil in the world. When many people ask, you know, why is there so much pain and evil in the world and so much suffering? As much as they try to use stories of the Bible to
mm-hmm.
to give a good definition as to why there is evil, we can philosophize it, and it's possible. You know, it's never really sufficient, because there is still evil. But Christianity has an end by itself, is giving us that true hope that evil by itself is not always meaningless, because through the evil we see in the world, God is birthing good. And we hang on to that hope. And so with that in mind, Jesus has that view of God restoring the world through this one painful experience he's about to have, of mm-hmm. which in other books like Matthew, we see that he knows what is about to happen. There's a struggle with him internally as a human to go through that. But he knows that ultimately through that action, there will be so much goodness coming from it.
Yeah, that's right. It's important for people to grasp that idea and understand what is going on here. It's a battle of the wills. There is the human will, and then there's the God's will. And Peter, as innocent as he is presenting his human will. This is not what we're talking about when we talk about the Messiah. And of course, it was a blurry vision. And then Jesus strikes back at calling him a Satan. And that part, I just want people to get, because every time people see Satan in the Bible, Satan has, I don't know how, this is why I enjoy trying to understand history or understand how things come to develop, because it's just an accuser. Even I teach in class, you have some students, when you do debate, you say some people are for and some people are against. The ones who are against are Satans. They're basically just accusers. They come and oppose what the people that are for. And so we use that every day, just not that word. And so that word now becomes so, and that's why I've seen a lot of people preach that it was a demon that got into Peter. And then out of that comes a lot of preachings of demons can get into your own friends, even as Christians, and they do. No, that's not basically what it is. It's just classic what this is, human will against what God's will. This is, you don't have the mind and concerns of God, because concerns of God is to save, but he's a Messiah, all right, but not in the way they're thinking. And then he now stresses that in the next verse. He says, then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, whoever wants to be my disciple. Now, see that now, from you are the Messiah. Peter rebukes him. He rebukes Peter back, and then he says, let me make it clear to you, just in case you don't understand what you're signing up for. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. There's a burden there. There's suffering there. For whoever wants to save their life, who's so concerned, I believe this is a direct shade at Peter, because Peter is the one who is trying to preserve his life at that moment. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it, because there's nothing you're holding on to. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. I think if we read this within context, it becomes clearer what Jesus is trying to point out, or what Jesus is trying to point out here. You are seeing a Messiah in a different light. And it kind of looks like if you are seeing the Messiah in a different light, then it's a kind of life you're expecting after the Messiah restores the kingdom. Does that make sense? There's an expectation of the kind of life you start living. You're probably thinking, yeah, finally, everything will be good. We're going to be our own. And we who are follow Jesus, we're going to have, how do you call that? Preferred places to sit. I mean, there's an expectation that is not matching what God's plan is. And he's saying, if you want to be my disciples, you will deny yourselves. You will let go of these things that you grab onto. As a matter of fact, you might not even have a life. And you have to take up your cross. And cross is just significant with suffering. They knew about this. It was something they were aware of. Crucifixion was pretty much a punishment I was given during that time. And carrying a cross is something they have, experience with. You will follow me carrying a cross. There is a burden you'll be carrying. And so if you're looking up to, I don't want this suffering, I don't want that, let's try as much as possible to avoid issues and avoid problems. Remember when his family came to call him and said, Jesus, what nonsense are you saying? People are going to kill you. Come out here and come back home. And Jesus is, who are my father, who are my mother, right? He literally threw that shade. So here they're saying, whoever wants to save their life, you will lose it. Because eventually, this life is worth nothing. Of course, this ties into a lot of his other teachings where he's saying, build for yourself treasures somewhere else where it's not going to get destroyed. But Mark is pointing this out. I'll give it to you here soon. And then he says, whoever loses their life for the sake of me does not... When he says loses their life, I could say it in a literal or in a figurative context. Losing your life, forget about everything you're holding on to and just focus on him. You will gain more. And when you are thinking of, oh, we're just restoring a Roman kingdom, what good is it in gaining the world? Okay, you restored your kingdom. Okay, now you are in control. You've gained the world. What good is it if your soul is not in the right place? It's still going to be the same chaos. And I think this is Jesus trying to point their direction into a brighter vision or a clearer vision into what his kingdom is about. Because you can't give anything in exchange for your soul. And so in following him, there is a cross, there is a burden, there is sufferings there. There is oppositions there. But don't be ashamed of me in the midst of that. Stand with me. For whoever is not ashamed, I will not be ashamed of. I will speak of them well in my Father's glory. Yeah, we have a few time left, but Jose, go ahead and then I'll come back in.
I think just whenever I read this portion here, you know, mm-hmm. Where Jesus addresses the crowd, or Luke 14, which is quite similar to a message here about counting mm-hmm. the cost of what it means to be a disciple, before I think about me in my own life now, as a student of history, I start to imagine Mark's immediate context. Mm-hmm. The people who are being killed for their faith.
Mm-hmm.
All the persecuted Christians of that time.
Yeah.
And how this message is going to cut deep, especially for those who are then abandoning the faith to think that
mm-hmm.
this Jesus is not worth it. This is a call that Jesus is saying. You have placed your faith rightly, but it's coming at its steep cost, which can
mm-hmm.
be your life. However, the cost of it is way, like, it's nothing compared to how much you stand to gain from that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember there's this statement by Lee Bonhoeffer, the German theologian, that I always would remember. He says, when God calls a man, he bids him to come and die, or to go and die.
Mm-hmm.
And in a sense, there is a steep price, like you said, to believe in the gospel. Aside from the fact that for them in their time, you would, you know, it's saying that you're going to die a physical death.
Mm-hmm.
But for us to, when we think about it figuratively in a way, there is a giving up of what you think life is. And for these people in Jesus's time, Jesus is saying, I am the Messiah, yes. But what that means is different. And so for you to be part of my discipleship, for you to be under me, you have to utterly give up everything you hold close to what you think is true about life in general. Your whole view of life, you have to let that go. You cannot, and this is why Christianity is not an add-on. You know, many people live their lives as, you know, I do the God thing on Sunday, or I do the God thing. Jesus is just, it's me, and then Jesus is an add-on to my life. No, Jesus is not that kind of guy. He is Lord, and when he shows up in your life, he's going to start demolishing the walls. Like, imagine you invite somebody into your house and he just shows up with his crew and they have a sledgehammer and they start smacking things down. And you're just like, no, that is Jesus. Jesus is that. There is an absolute letting go of everything you have, we are holding dear to your life. You know, in Luke, he puts it as, you would hate your father and mother, even your own self, because you know what are the things that we in our modern day would hold firmly, you know, our sense of identity, our sense of self, our sense of family and relational and relationship, sorry, all those things would have to fall. I know we're stretching for time, but one of the questions that many people would ask is the question here, especially in this part of the world that we're in, is the question of sexuality, and is becoming a huge topic. And I know this is a very tough topic to talk about, but for me, Jesus knocks down all the walls and rebuilds them, but he's not just knocking down those walls because he's evil. He is a good and faithful father who is not, the remodeling he is trying to do is way beyond you can imagine. So your sense of identity, yourself of family and friendship and career, he knocks them down.
Mm-hmm.
You have to let that go. But what he gives you in turn, the profit, what you stand to gain outweighs all of that. So even your sense of identity towards any form of leaning, or it may not be that, but what you think your career is, you know, how I am going to orient my life towards something, your sense of self-actualization, Jesus knocks that down too, because he's going to knock down everything you have in your heart that is Lord, that is leading your life. But this is because he is a good kind of God. Because ultimately, all those things, once they become gods, would lead you to a very bad place. Like you were describing earlier. Say they erect Israel as the new kingdom. Israel would just equally be as bad as Rome. It's just a change of power. Like we have been doing in certain countries, but the same situation is going to happen. But what Jesus is trying to do is change the whole system completely. So the kingdom becomes a different kind of thing. So no longer are you chasing all those things, but because of him, your sense of value and worth doesn't come from your relationships. your identity, but is embedded and is found in him. He gives you that sense of value now, so much so that life becomes free. And this is why when he said, come unto me, and I will teach you how to live lightly and freely. This is what it meant. There is a cost to it because there is a giving up of so much you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
But what you stand to gain is out of this world.
Yeah, amazing. And the thing is, when he told them to take up their cross, it's classic. We saw that happen when Jesus was crucified eventually. People who were crucified were to carry their cross all the way to execution. And on the way carrying the cross, there will be mocking. There will be people opposing. There will be people laughing. There will be people stoning. This is what it feels like to follow Jesus, the Messiah. You'll be mocked. You'll be opposed. It's like when someone says, if your belief in Christianity is going on the same way with the world, then you probably have believed wrongly, because Christianity is always opposing the world structure, and it is always not going with, it's countercultural most of the times. And so if we're following the Messiah, if our idea of following the Messiah is so that we just get established and, you know, gain it all, then we've missed the whole point. And this is the clear vision Jesus is trying to give the disciples now. He looks back and says, you're following the Messiah, but I think you're following for the wrong reason. You're seeing it wrongly. Peter has echoed that now. You need to understand that there is suffering here. There is denial of self, and that's a very huge one. There is a denial of self in this following. There is setting aside things that you've held so dearly. And when he says you're setting them aside, it's not necessarily you're abandoning them. It's that you don't hold them. They don't form your identity. You don't hold on to them so dearly, like, without them, I wouldn't survive. God becomes your entire focus. And that's the key thing. The idea of even eternal life worth losing your life over is something that is in deuterocanonical books, not in the Protestant version of the Bible, but you find that in Book of Enoch or Book of Baruch, which other branch of Christianity have. There's a belief that, you know, you can, eternal life is worth losing your life over. So it was a concept they understood when he said that. It wasn't weird to them. And so Jesus is calling us to a life of self-abandonment. And that has continually been my reflection over the past few days and few weeks, is you are following Christ, but there has to be a give. There has to be a giving up. What is this faith that is not translating to your actual life? What is this faith that is not being practical that you have? What ideas are you setting up in your mind about following the Messiah? And I think that culture is what Jesus is challenging there. What do you have in your mind? This is not what following the Messiah is all about. It's not all beds of roses, or how do you call that? It's not all fun and games. No, it's life and death. But count the cost and following him. And he says, if you do this and you're not ashamed of going through this, I won't be ashamed of you. I will not. In fact, I will speak of you well. When I first got born again as a Christian, I found that scripture. It was October 27. I think it was 2009. I remember. I'd never read that scripture. I'm just new as a Muslim, so I've never read that scripture before. And then I had a dream, and that's, it just jumped from, like, he read it to me in the dream. Yeah. I've never seen it, never heard it. I'm not lying to you. Then I had to go search for where it was in the Bible, and I found it in Mark here. You stay with him. And so I call on those who are listening today. We have seen that journey of what Peter thinks the Messiah is, and echoing the thoughts of the disciples and what Jesus is saying. Are you ready to deny yourself in following him? Or are we following him as a way to satisfy ourselves? Does that make sense? Where we just use him as a satisfaction for ourselves? No.
Yeah.
We are called to deny and abandon what we hold dear. Like you said, tearing down the walls, allowing him rebuild. So when you say, God, lead me, God, I trust you, be ready to get your walls kicked down. Be ready to be confronted. Be ready to be torn apart. Be ready to see how bad of a person you are, and allow him rebuild you. And he says it is worth it in the end.
Yeah.
So this is, was it Mark chapter 9? Oh my God, I've lost my, This is Mark chapter 8. And the moment Jesus talks about, how do you call that? His death, or rather his possible death. And Peter calls him the Messiah. The story starts getting, interesting from there. So we have now reached the first half. We finished the first half of the book of Mark. We are entering into the second half where it gets, the plot gets ticking, right? So I hope everyone has been amazing. We have just gone over 1 hour. I wanted us to be under 1 hour, but...
So I mean, it's an improvement from the last time.
We have 2 hours worth of recording for the book of Mark chapter 8. That's quite interesting. So go listen. I hope you all have been blessed. Thank you, Jose, for being a part of this. We are going to continue with Mark chapter 9, and it gets quite interesting. So I hope you've read. We're going to split Mark chapter 9 in two as well, because it has about 50 verses in there. So we'll probably split it in two as well, so that we'll be able to cover some depth. So please make sure that you take your time to study these on your own. If you have questions, please always try to ask. You can send them in or drop them as a comment. I'll try my best to address them. I would address them. And part of the plans for this particular podcast is that after we're done with Book of Mark, in between, I will be having also some interesting topics that we'll talk about as well, basically to just cover some bases in Christianity. So I look forward to sharing that with you, viewers. God bless you, and we will be seeing. Jose, you have any last words? In 10 seconds, I'm counting down now.
Now, just know that as God is asking you to give up your life, is that God is really good. So he's not just this evil guy scattering your house and doing nothing about it, but he's a really good God. So you giving up that is for something even better, just to do that.
Actually, he's taking a very, very gentle approach. I don't think, don't even look forward to anything good. God is going to tear down your life, take it that way, because when you're looking forward to something good, it will still motivate you to say, at least I'm going to get something good. No, have it in mind that nothing good is going to happen. It's going to tear your life down and see what happens afterwards. God bless you. I'll see you in the next episode.
God bless you.